Morning, everyone. I'm Nikos Lewis. I'm working for two companies at the moment. One Slash is one where we're part of the sponsors for this event, and the Pace Systems, where we mainly do online transaction processing of medical aid claims. So we're the middleman between the pharmacies, the doctors, and the medical aids, where we transfer those electronic claims to the medical aid, and then that response back to your service provider. Just a resource also that you might find helpful is by every month we've got the Postgres user group here in Gauteng. We're mostly meeting at the EOH offices at Route 21 Corporate Office Park close by on the R21 here. Today, so I'm going to talk about how you can customize the Postgres command line client to maybe make a few things easier for you and help with that. Who of you mainly use the command line client as your main client for accessing the databases? A few. The others, mainly pgAdmin, I guess. Some other tools you might use, DataGrip. Okay, so I think most of it's then going to be new to what I'm going to say. I have to run quickly through this. We don't have a lot of time, and I can't do too much demos. First of all, there's a file that sits in your home directory called pgpass, which you can put in passwords for databases. Okay? This file only works if the permissions on it is you are, as the user, is the only one that can have read and write access to that file. So it's the same as your SSH keys, for example. If that file doesn't have that permissions, you won't, that file will be ignored and not used by your Postgres command line client. Just quickly, what is in that file? It makes use of a colon as the separator. So it's the host name, the port, database, the username, and then the password that will be used. So then you don't need to type in a password on the command line. It does match from wildcards there and there. So you must make sure that whatever the order is important in which you put these lines, okay? So it will match the most specific option it finds first. Okay, so if that line, for example, was the first one, doesn't matter which other host it will be connecting to, it will try and use that. If you connect to a marketing database, you can connect to any host. With that marketing database, that's the username and that's the password that will be used. For example, if you run on custom ports, you can specify the different port number. Otherwise, that you can, if it's the default port numbers, you don't need to specify any port numbers. Yeah, that's mostly the important things there. Okay, then the other file we're going to talk about is the PSQL-RC file. That is mainly what the talk is going to be about. There are two files, or in two locations, where you can find this file. You either have a global file that normally lives in etc PSQL-RC. If you're on Windows, there is also, just look in the documentation, you'll find where you can place that file for use. So if you make use, say, for example, of a configuration management tool like Ansible, it's easy to put that file in. It depends on how you want to configure it, whether everyone has access to it or not. You can either put it in the global etc, otherwise you can put it in a user's home directory. Yeah, the file permissions doesn't matter. So as long as the user has read rights, it should be able to use that file. Okay, first, there's a few settings on it. So the prompt one, this is the same thing as you can set in a bash shell or any of the Linux shells. So percentage M, capital or the lowercase one, is either the full host name or the truncated host name, which you can use then to build up your prompt. The percentage N will show you the current username. /, the name of the current database. Then you've got some special characters that you can use in your prompt to give you some more indication of where you connected to and what your role are, for example. So regular users, you'll see there's always this, well, call it a greater than sign, or and if you're a super user, you'll see the hash sign. It doesn't mean just a Postgres user. If your user has super user access, you'll also see the hash. Then capital R will show you whether you've, say, missed a bracket or a semicolon before the query is executed. I'll show you examples of how that worked. The next one, percentage X, will show you your transaction status. Okay, so if there's nothing, if you don't see either, So if you don't see either the star or exclamation mark, you're not inside the transaction. So when you're inside a transaction, you'll see the asterisk and the exclamation mark when the transaction has failed, for example. Okay, so there's a quick example of what you can use for your prompt. So that's your username, the host, the database, and there's those three special characters. Okay, so we normally Okay, so we're not inside a transaction, nothing has failed, we're just a normal Postgres user. Okay, so now we're inside a transaction, like I said. Now there's that asterisk is there. After you type in begin and press enter, you'll see that asterisk. So you can either then roll back or commit to get back to your default transaction status or to cancel that transaction. Let's say, for example, there's a query that failed while you're inside a transaction. Okay, so we started a transaction. It indicates that to us, and now we do something silly like a division by zero. That, and there's the exclamation showing us that that transaction has failed. And then you can just, okay, then in this case, you have to do a rollback. There's an example, if you're a power user, just there at the end, you'll get your hash signed for that. Then the other nice thing, if you really want to go and do, you can do a lot of customizers, the same as in your Linux shells, this gets rather difficult to read, and you need to break this up. I'm not going to go through the detail of that, but you can get a prompt, for example, that looks like that. And you can give different colors to the username, to the database, or to the host. You just, like in the shell prompts, need to figure out your color sequences that you specify and where they start and end. Then there's also a setting for a prompt too, and that's the default setting. You'll see now that this line doesn't have a semicolon on it, so it expects more input. That's why there's a single dash there. So there you continue with your query, put your semicolon, you press enter. Now, I, for example, like to change that and just to set it to two single quotes there, which will actually just not display anything on your second or third lines thereafter. I do this mainly because now what can happen is I can copy this query into another editor or somewhere else where I want to use it. Okay, so you don't need, they need to go and delete all this stuff in front every time. Okay, that just helps a bit of if you need to copy that. The next one, same as they've copied, you'll see they've copied a lot of stuff out of the Linux and Unix worlds. So you can specify a history file, which will save all the queries that you've executed with your client. That will normally, the default will go into PSQL history, and there's the path if you're on Windows. Then what the other nice thing that you can do with it is you can also tell it to save a history file per database. So then you'll see there you've got a history file for DVD rental, and there's the normal one if you don't specify any DB names. So that file then, if you specify a DB name, all the queries for that specific database will go into that file. So you can, if you have different clients, you can separate those into every client that you work for example. Then the other thing that in some of the graphical clients, they do make this easier. I'm ahead of myself here. History control, the default option is none. Then they've got options ignore space, ignore dupes, ignore both. What ignore space means is if you put a space in front of the query, it doesn't save it into your history file. If you have the ignore dupes option, sometimes you repeat the same query over and over and over to see how stuff is progressing. Okay, that will then not put that query into your history file again. So you'll end up with one query in the history file. Ignore both will just do combine the two options together. Null values. This is a difficult one on the command line by default. You don't sometimes know whether this thing is null or is it an empty space. So there, for example, I selected null, but in that value, you don't really know, is it really null or is it the empty space? So we can set the value we want to have displayed when that there's a null value. I just said put it in square brackets. Other people use angle brackets. Some other signs they use, you'll see a lot of examples on the internet. Then we can customize how the borders looks around some of these tables when we get our results. There's line style option for ASCII, Alt, ASCII, Unicode. You'll see the first two ASCII and Alt ASCII actually looks the same. That just means it defines on how these lines are, which characters are used to draw these lines, and these tables column separators there. If you use Unicode, you'll see you'll get a bit of nicer lines in here, especially on this horizontal line here. I just copied the text into the presentation here, so there's a bit of spaces here, but I'll show you an actual screenshot where that doesn't happen. You actually have nice looking tables. Your border value, you can customize that to set how many borders are used and where they're placed. For example, border null doesn't print any column separators there. Border one will put in the column separators. Border two will actually give you a complete table then. Now, if you combine that with line style Unicode, you'll see now we've got a nice looking square table there, if you ignore the spaces there. And now there's a nice long line that you can set a few things, border to line style Unicode. Unicode border also line style double or single. I've liked mine to be a double. Some people just use single. The same for the header line. And the column line style single, that's the line in between the columns. So then you have a table that looks like that. Okay, that sometimes, I don't know, I just find it easy to read things when it looks like that with not all of these extra spaces in between the rows, but that's a personal preference. Something else you'll find is that you can specify how the data is presented to you. Whether it's aligned, unaligned. Aligned is the default, then you've got wrapped, HTML, ASCII doc, LaTeX, another LaTeX, and TROF FMS. I've never heard of that. I don't know what that is, so don't ask me. So you can actually have this, your queries output HTML or ASCII doc, if you have to copy this into another document as part of your documentation, or it will generate LaTeX for you. Okay, so unaligned basically takes away any spaces around your columns, and it will do that. This is helpful, for example, if you now take this output and put it into, say, a spreadsheet where you can say, I've got a pipe as a delimiter, and this will put it into columns into your spreadsheet. Okay, aligned, that's the default value. You've all seen that one. Okay, now, for example, That's the default option, but your terminal, for example, isn't wide enough to display a row. So what it will do is it will wrap into the next line, and there's the last column value. Okay, this sometimes makes it difficult to read your results. So I prefer to use the format wrapped. So wrapped is basically a line format, but what it does is, you'll now see, it put this into a single column spanning over two rows, and you still have your third column, which makes this a lot easier to read. Okay, we, for example, have a few byte A columns in our database. That's a blob, basically. So by default, Postgres encode this byte arrays into X. As you can see, this is not really readable. What you can now do is you can tell the byte A output to set it to escape, and that will automatically convert that X back into readable text. Okay, another option is the expanded option, or backslash X. That's the normal one. Now, if you enable the expanded mode, what that will do now is it will actually display this record like in a single two-column table, with the columns now becoming a row each. Okay, sometimes if your table is long or you have a lot of columns, this makes it easier reading. But then also you can specify it to backslash expanded auto or backslash X auto. Then the client or the application itself will decide which one of those two formats it will use for displaying the information. Then what I actually find nice is you can set a pager to be used, which is actually nice, because the default pager they use is the less on Linux. I'm not sure what they use in Windows for the pager. If you go to that project, you can find this pager there that helps you actually to scroll left and right, up and down through your result sets. You can customize it. It's got a lot more options than what I've got there. For example, I hate the mouse interfering here. So look at that project if you want a pager. Then, for example, the DBAs, mostly you sometimes want to know who's the users connected to your system. There's queries for determining long-running queries, who's got locks on what tables, rows, etc. So what you can do in your PSQL file is you can have a query and assign it an alias variable name. So that allows you not to, or then it makes it easy. You just have to give it, use that name, or colon and the name you gave it there. So there's users, and there's the query we want to execute. And you type colon users, this also actually tab completion will help you there as well, and you have your query executed without you having to remember all these sometimes difficult queries that you want to execute. Okay, that was really a quick intro into what you can do on that on your PSQL command line client, and what you how you can customize it. There's a lot of other options available that I haven't covered, but please go through the documentation. There's a lot of references. The slides will also be available after the conference for those that want access to them. So there's all the resources. If you have a quick question or two, we can probably cover them. Questions? Otherwise, find me somewhere and come and ask me if you want to know something. Right, thank you.